We continue to investigate our simple example. We have been developing a model. We have specified it. It contains three parameters, pi1, pi2, pi3. And using the data that we have collected, we have been able to estimate the value of these parameters. But clearly, these values have been calculated using statistical inference, assuming that what we calculate in the sample can generalize to the population. But we do mistakes by doing this. There are errors in these estimates. And can we have a sense of how accurate these estimates are? This is the topic of this video. So these are the three values of the parameters that we have estimated from the contingency table. For example, pi hat 1 is 65 divided by 900. 65 is the number of people who own an electric car and belong to the first age category. And 900 is the total number of people who belong to age category 1. So it is about 7.22%. And we do the same for the next two parameters. In general, the first thing we do when we estimate parameters is to look at the values and do an informal check. Do they make sense? The value, do they match our a priori expectations? Well, here we observe that as age increases, the market share of electric car decreases. And actually, this is something that could be expected because we expect younger people to be more attracted by this new technology. So this is not completely unexpected, and we may accept this kind of results. So that's the type of thing that we do first when we estimate the parameters of the model, just informal checks. But this is not sufficient. We also want to do more formal and rigorous tests to have an idea of the quality of the estimates. And because pi hat, the estimates of the parameters, have been obtained from statistical inference, the main question is, how is this value different from the true value of the parameter in the population? And obviously, we have no access to the true value of the parameter from the population. This is why we do inference. So actually, each time you sample, you will obtain a different value for the estimate, for each different sample, because each sample is randomly drawn. So therefore, this value of the estimate is distributed. Each time you draw a sample, you get a different value for pi hat j. So for example, the distribution of pi hat 2 can be seen as this curve. In this example, I assume that the true value of pi 2 is equal to 0.048. But from the sample that we have collected, we have estimated that the value of the parameter is 0.05. It's different from the true value. And if I had drawn another sample, I would have found another value, and all these values would follow this distribution. In general, all the estimators that we will be using are unbiased or asymptotically unbiased. It means that the true value of the parameter is the expectation of the estimate. Of course, this distribution, we hope that it is not too spread, because if it is spread, we may end up with estimates which are far away from the true value of the parameters. And the spread of the distribution is actually associated with the size of the sample. Smaller samples are associated with a wider spread. So the larger the sample, the better the estimate. So it's always worth investing in large sample. But in practice, I cannot really analyze the distribution, the empirical distribution of the estimates. This would involve collecting several samples and each time calculating the value of the estimates and do it again and again. So in practice, it's not possible. Therefore, in general, the distributions of these estimators are derived from theoretical results or by simulation. If you change the sample size, the spread, that is called the variance of the distribution, increases. So in this example, I have plotted the original shape of the distribution of pi 2 hat in blue for a sample size of 2,500 that we use in our simple example. But if I calculate the distribution for a sample of size 1,000, I obtain a distribution with a much bigger variance. And therefore, I have more chance to obtain an estimate that is far away from the true value of the parameter. In order to calculate statistical property, we need to go back to the main random variables which are involved in this model. The random variables are very simple because each person can respond two things to the question, right? So you can observe that it owns a car, so it owns an electric car, or it does not own an electric car. So random variables which are 0 or 1 with some probability are called Bernoulli random variables. So here the probability that the random variable is 1 is pi j in h category j, and the variance of a Bernoulli variable is given by the probability of a success times the probability of a failure. So it's the probability that the person owns an electric car times the probability that the person does not own an electric car. And when you calculate the sample average, like we did in this example, we have a non-biased estimator of the true value of the parameter. And the standard error, so basically the average spread around the mean, is calculated as the ratio between the variance and the sample size, and you take the square root of this. So the estimated standard error is obtained by calculating the variance using this formula. Of course, we don't know the true value of the parameter, so we replace it by the estimated value, pi hat j, and we divide by the number of people. So the standard error for the parameter associated with h category j, because it's calculated based on the number of people in this category, nj is equal to the number of people in the h category j. So I suggest now that you calculate the standard errors using this formula of the estimates that you have obtained from the contingency table. And afterwards, we will look into a more complex estimator, which is called the maximum likelihood estimator, which is the one that we will use later in the course. Actually, in this case, in the case of the simple example, it will happen to be the same estimates as for the sample average. But we will look into this from the point of view of the maximum likelihood estimation.